In honor of Asian American and Pacific Islander Heritage Month, here's Sri Jana with a song from Nepal.
Hey everybody, welcome to the Cristo Rey podcast. This is May, which is Asian American History Month, and welcome to a special Asian American History podcast. I'm your host, Ujjal, and I'm here with your other host, Icy.
Hi.
And Jade.
Hey guys.
And today our guests are Andy, Nishan, Srijana, Selena, and Anisha. We also have a special guest today, as in the form of Mrs. Corrigan.
Hi, everyone.
Okay, so I have the first question. What does your Asian heritage mean to you?
I think it means Asian heritage and being Asian in America means a lot to me, especially because, like, I'm from Nepal and, like, I don't know, a lot of who I am right now and who I will be in the future, I think, is defined by the fact that I'm Asian. So it means a lot to me.
Kind of piggybacking off of what Nishan said, I agree, like, my Asian heritage means almost like everything to me. That's a part of my identity. And I believe that without my identity, like, everything I do is, like, I tie it with my culture, I tie it with me being Nepali. So yeah, that's what it means to me.
For me, it means that spreading, like, awareness or letting people know about, like, you know, the different countries in Asia and, like, their cultures and all that stuff, because not a lot of people, like, really, like, when people ask me where I'm from, I would say Nepal, and they wouldn't even know that, like, it existed. So it's like spreading awareness.
I would agree with you, Jana, because I was about to say it typically meant my whole identity and what I grew up with and, like, you know, what my whole family and everyone around me has been, like, my family, friends, and so they all have been, like, raised by that and all. I wanted to say that it's a big part of my identity, and it's what I've known for, like, what I have been known since I was very young.
To add to what I said before, being Asian American, being Nepali American also means, like my family, you know. I think family is a huge part of a lot of Asian cultures, and a lot of, like, Nepali culture revolves around family. We're about to celebrate my grandpa's birthday, and, like, we're inviting, like, everybody over and stuff. So, yeah, family is also something that's, like, very important to me because of my Asian heritage.
I'd also agree. My Asian heritage means a lot to me. I'm also from Nepal, but the month itself has little less meaning to me because I really didn't know about it until recently. And while I think it's good to spread awareness and everything, but specifically to me, it's not as useful because I celebrate my Asian heritage throughout the year.
I would like to also say that even we're still in America now, we still follow our traditional culture. Like, we celebrate every, like, Nepali festival we have.
So my background is a little bit different because my parents are non-Asian and they adopted me from South Korea. So I'm actually, my oldest brother is the only biological son. So I guess the way that I was raised was a little bit differently because my parents celebrated many Asian cultures in our family. So just because, you know, my siblings and I were from Korea. My mother's father was in the Navy, and so she was stationed in Japan with her family. My father served in the Navy during Vietnam. So we were introduced to a lot of different Asian cultures. So I grew up appreciating many different cultures, even though I wasn't necessarily from all these different countries. I grew to appreciate many different Asian cultures.
Hey Cougars, Miss Gabriel here. I want to say congratulations to all of the students who took AP exams this year. There were 213 AP exams given to 138 students. There were countless hours of study and prep, so kudos to each of you for taking on that challenge. You've worked hard all year and I'm so proud. Great job.
How does your family celebrate your cultural background?
Our cultural background, it's defined by like a lot of holidays. So some of the major holidays that Nepali people share is Dasain, which literally is like a family gathering. We go to our family's houses, our distant relatives, like that's the time we catch up with everyone. We get everyone's blessings, just have fun, you know, like we go out to eat in their houses and everything. And then the next one we have is Diwali, also Tiyar, typically known in Nepal like as Tiyar, but we also like come together and we just celebrate that familial bond that we have with each other. And then like Holi is also like a big one that we celebrate with our community. So yeah, that's just how we like celebrate it. We come together as a community and just celebrate each other with food and all that.
And also to add to that, some of like the best aspects of our culture is like how we have like a sense of community. So it's not like we have to have a holiday to celebrate, you know, like we'll throw like random family reunions like all throughout the year and stuff, and like we'll just have family gatherings, like, you know, just make any excuse for our family gathering and like, you know, meet together and stuff like that, which is like I think really amazing and like a really cool aspect of our culture.
Yeah, I don't even think you need a family gathering because people will just show up out of nowhere and just be like, okay, we're doing this now.
Yeah, that too, you know, like the random family members just popping up out the cut. I think that's cool as well.
Yeah, that's funny because just yesterday, like five family members showed up to my house and we had a little small reunion. So yeah, it just happens throughout the year. But I think a lot of the community aspect comes from back in Nepal, because unlike in America, people are really closer together and we just interact with each other more on a regular basis. And I think that spread over here when some of us came to America, because we still interact with each other like a community without a lot of those barriers. Because I've noticed, unlike in Nepal, America has a lot more barriers between people. Even if you're getting to know others, it's a little different, let's say.
Yeah, and to add to what Ujwal said, I think we have that sense of community because we had to rebuild from scratch. If you guys don't know, a lot of Nepalese are refugees, and the ones that moved here are mostly refugees, especially in Columbus. And what happened was, in Bhutan, everybody, like a lot of Nepalese and a lot of ethnic Nepalese were in this country called Bhutan, but the population of the Nepali community in Bhutan started growing rapidly. So a lot of them, most of them got kicked out and they had to move back and relocate to Nepal. And even though they had their citizenship and like they were full citizens of Bhutan, they still got kicked out. There was a refugee crisis that happened. And when that happened, all those people had to restart. They didn't have a passport or like they didn't have a citizenship for any country. So they had to build their community on their own and they had to start from scratch, basically. Like if you look up houses in Nepal or like refugee camps in Nepal, like you can see the conditions that they lived in. And that sense of community, I think, helped a lot at that point because we helped each other and we helped each other grow and build, which is really cool.
Hi guys, Halonga here. Last month something very mysterious happened. An announcement came over the PA system telling all seniors to report to the chapel for an emergency meeting. Uh-oh, were we in trouble? When we got there, Mrs. Fisher and Mrs. Pettit were there. They looked serious. Everyone got quiet and then Mrs. Pettit made this announcement. After the announcement, we went downstairs and saw all the younger students lined up in the halls, clapping and cheering. Then we went outside for celebration and cake. We recorded the live reaction. Let's listen.
So hey, it's Olonga over here. We just heard that we had 100% college acceptance, all seniors. And I'm here with one of my classmates, Moni, to tell us about what's going on today and how he feels about it.
We got 100% college acceptance! Yeah!
We did it, guys. And did you know every graduating class of Cristo Rey Columbus High School has achieved 100% college acceptance? The class of 2022 was determined to keep the streak going. And we did it. Go class of 2022.
So what you said about Bataan, and so that's actually true, because my mom and dad, they were both born in Bataan. Then like later on, I guess they got kicked out and they had to like find new places to live in. My mom went to India. But then later she moved to Nepal, and my dad like just came to Nepal with his family members because like some of his family members were already there.
Yeah, my father is also from Bhutan. He's Nepali, but he got kicked out. It was a little worse than what you're describing though, because it was more like an ethnic cleansing. They were murdering people because they were Nepali, so they had to leave or they'd probably die. After that, there was a civil war in Nepal near 2005-ish, and I think it stopped during 2006, so it was a rough time.
Yeah, I didn't mean to downplay what happened. Yeah, it was an ethnic cleansing, and it was terrible. People lost their lives, and they were told that if they didn't leave, they would be killed. So yeah, let's not downplay the refugee crisis of Bhutan.
I agree with what they say, because my grandpa used to tell me a story that how they had to move from Bhutan because they were scared to live there, and my parents were really young, so they didn't want anything bad to happen, so they literally moved to Nepal, and they still told me the story about how like it was terrible in Bhutan and how they were like scared to live there, so all of the family members, neighbors, they were like running away from Bhutan to save themselves.
Yeah, like my grandpa, he was arrested, and I don't know how long he stayed in the prison, but like eventually everyone like moved away and like went to Nepal to refugee camps. It was in Jaba, which is like, I think it's a city in Nepal. And my parents were like in eighth grade, I think. So they were like pretty young.
They pretty much said everything, but to kind of tie it all together, yeah, our parents, even us, like being born in refugee camps, that just kind of build like a sense of community, which we still like keep very like near and dear to our heart, even to this day.
I don't know much about my biological parents, except my mother and my grandmother hid me in a closet for about the first 3 years of my life. So I'm not quite sure who, I don't have any contact with any of my family in Korea. I don't know if I have siblings or who my parents are or anything like that. But definitely my mother wanted a better life for me. So her only option was to take me to an orphanage to be adopted. So that's how I ended up in the United States. But definitely your stories are very heartbreaking in terms of, you know, what your families had to go through in order to get you to America. But it's probably good to say that somehow we've all ended up in America with much better lives due to the sacrifices that our parents made for us. So that's pretty awesome.
Yeah, the emphasis on the sacrifices that our parents made for us, because like the amount that our families have done for us, I think all Asians can say that, like the amount that our parents have done for us and how they have set us up for success is like truly beautiful. And I feel like it's very unique, or like not really unique, but like just like it's a really amazing trait that our community has.
Hey guys, Julia here. This weekend saw the return of Cristo Rey's biggest fundraising as a live event, the Garden Party. The Garden Party helps fundraise for programs like sports, student clubs, field trips, and many other exciting things. This year, the Garden Party was held at The Five, a stunning space within awesome, amazing, luxurious skyline view. The night featured live music from Columbus' own Mojo Flow, and a special program featured Cristo Rey graduates Vanessa, class of 2017, and Megumi, class of 2021. They were joined in a conversation by current senior, Paul. The whole event was moderated by NBC4 news anchor, Matt Barnes. This is a big thank you to all donors and volunteers who helped make this incredible event possible. Viva Cristo Rey.
I agree with that. Family sacrifice things, because after we came over here, like, our parents had to work a lot to, you know, sustain a life for us. Thankfully, I had my other family here before, and they were able to, you know, support us while we got our things together, and, you know, got ready to live a new life in America. And see, like, during that time, seeing my parents work to sustain us and come home tired was so heartbreaking, because it was nice, because, like, they were working their hardest for us, but it was also a little sad.
Right. I think that's certainly something that we don't want to ever forget, is who we are and what our families have done for us. In terms of what they've sacrificed so that we could be in America and have all the rights that we have as Americans. So we definitely don't want to ever forget our families.
Have you guys ever visited Nepal? And if so, what was that experience like for you?
So I've actually never went back to Nepal after I came here. I was 3 when I came here, so I don't have much memories of it. I don't remember anyone. And it gets really awkward in conversations when they're like, oh, do you remember me? I'm like, I'm sorry, I don't. I haven't been. I know Sean has been there. I think it was in 2019 or 2020.
Yeah, I went there in 2019. And I think it was a really cool experience, because, like, at that time, I feel like I was, like, really starting to mature and stuff. And, like, seeing what my heritage was like in person, you know, not through pictures, not through stories, but, like, with my own eyes, I think it was literally eye-opening. So, like, I love the experience, and I definitely, like, recommend going back to, like, whatever country that, like, you are from, or, like, going back to Nepal for you guys, you know. Convince your parents, tell me, it's amazing.
Yeah, I'm planning to go soon too, like, maybe within a couple years, but no, I haven't gone back either, similar to Nisha. But I mean, I do have, like, I was around 5 or 6 when I came to America, but I do have, like, a fairly good memory of my surroundings, which was just the refugee camp that I lived in. So I wouldn't say I got, like, a good experience of Nepal, because I was just in my, like, you know, refugee camp. I just know, like, I vividly remember, like, my refugee camp, and that's pretty much about it. So I'm really excited to go back and actually see my country for what it's, like, known for, like, the mountains and all the beautiful, like, cities and all that.
I'm also like you. I left during when I was 5, and I haven't been back, but I do remember a few things, especially about refugee camps and those sort of things. I'm pretty sure I went to school there for preschool as well, but we left right when I turned a little after 5.
I also have never been to Nepal, but my parents and my uncle will show me photos about, like, what was Nepal like, how was, like, our house looked like, how that I was as a baby. So I got, like, experience of Nepal from these photos and a little bit of memory my parents will share with me or show photos with.
So for me, I've never been to Nepal after I came here when I was around, like, 7 years old. But my aunt, like, my older cousin, and so they went to Nepal, like, a year ago, and they went, like, last week. So, yeah. But, and my uncle got married there. So that's the only thing I know. But other than that, but there's just one memory of me in Nepal. Like, I was at school with my friends. So that was the only memory I had. So other than that, I don't remember much.
Hey guys, Rebecca here. Want to help change the stigma about mental health? Some students created a skit to show you how, starring Sierra as MC, a very stressed out student. The scene, a boring math class.
And I'd like to know, A and B.
I can't take this anymore.
Later that day, MC tries to talk to her parents.
I'm not feeling well, and my class is making my mental health a lot worse. I think I need a therapist.
Nonsense. Therapist is for crazy people. You're perfectly normal, honey. You'll be fine.
Honey, mental illness doesn't exist. But if you're feeling physically ill, I can make an appointment at the clinic.
But not during the weekdays. She can't miss school. You'll get over it.
The next day at school, MC encounters a group of students in the hall.
Hey, look, it's the crazy girl. I'm surprised you're still here. Where's your straight jacket? Shouldn't you be in a men's ward?
Yeah, you were acting weird yesterday.
Hey, leave her alone. She was distressed in chem class, and you guys are going to be too late to pay attention.
The kind stranger takes MC aside and talks one-on-one.
Hey, do you want to go to Mr. Rose's office? I've been there a couple of times, and he's really nice and helpful. Come on, we can go.
What's the moral of the story? In the wise words of Tanaya, class of 2023, just because it takes more energy to be nice doesn't mean that it isn't worth it. If anything, be bold enough to do the right thing.
I know you guys talked about the refugee camps and all that, so how did they build it back up? And are they still in the process of that? And are, is there some interesting features down there different from America?
You're talking about the refugee camps, right?
Nepal in general and the refugee camps?
Well, I mean, specifically about the refugee camps, they were created, like, with the help of UNHCR after Nepal experienced the racial, like, injustice and the, what's it called? Ethnic cleansing in Bhutan. So it was established after that. And basically, our community, like our parents, grandparents, they had to build it. They had to build it up. It was never like there. But with the help of like UNHCR and all that, they got the resources they needed to build up these little villages. Like, you know what you would see when you see like poor rural areas in third world countries? That's pretty much like what the village was like.
Mrs. Corrigan, how has your identity of being Asian like impacted you throughout your life? Like, how did you think about it when you were younger, and how has that changed until now?
Well, it's funny that you asked that question, because when I was quite young, up until about 10, like I said, my oldest brother was the only biological son. And for some reason, and I had three other siblings who are also from Korea, although not biologically related to me. So I actually thought that my brother, the biological son, was the adopted one. And it never occurred to me until I was about 10 years old. I might be from a different country from my parents. And I remember being really shocked at the time, you know, the fact that I was adopted from Korea, and that my brothers and sisters, you know, I called them brothers and sisters, they weren't biologically related to me. So that was a big kind of an awakening moment for me when I was around 10 years old. I don't know why it took me so long to realize that. I don't know if it takes that long for most children who are adopted. But we lived in a pretty sheltered area growing up in Oregon. I grew up on the west coast of Oregon, so we weren't surrounded by a lot of other Asian children. So I remember getting a lot of comments as up until my teenage years, but I was homeschooled, so I was a little more sheltered. I did play with other children in my community, but I remember, you know, they would do the slanty eyes at me. They would call me, you know, Asians, what you would consider slurs now. So I really felt out of place for a very long time, up until I went to, because I was homeschooled up until high school. So then once I went to college, it was a little bit different because I was around more other Asian Americans or Asians. And I think of it now because we have Mr. Corrigan and I have 5 children, and I see in my children, because they're half Korean and they're half Irish, so they don't really realize that they're Korean. And I think that's kind of interesting to see it through, you know, a child's perspective, kind of like the perspective I had, that, you know, you don't really think about race or anything like that. And it isn't until people start pointing it out to you that you really start thinking about it. So yes, my idea of what it was like to be Asian was kind of different growing up because I was adopted. But I guess I want to say that, like, I want my children to fully embrace their Irish heritage as well as their Korean heritage. And I have, you know, given, I try to show them as much of their Korean heritage as I can as they grow up. That's very important to me, that they are aware of the fact that they are Korean as well as Irish.
Hello, everyone. This is Emily here, and on behalf of everyone at the Cristo Rey podcast, we want to wish Cristo Rey's marketing and operations director, Ms. Truitt, a huge congratulations. Why? Because Ms. Truitt is getting married tomorrow on May 14th. The Cristo Rey podcast would not be possible without Ms. Truitt's tireless efforts. She's the one who adds all the images and fun graphics to the podcast every week. For the time being, Mr. Corbin's going to have to do that himself. If the show doesn't look as good this week, now you know why. Enjoy your honeymoon, Mr. Truitt, but please come back soon. I don't know how long you can take it with just Mr. Corgan around. Anyways, congratulations. We'll see you soon.
You mentioned about, like, how it's kind of, like, surprising that your kids, like, are Korean and stuff. I think you said something about them not, like, realizing it. I was just wondering, like, do you think it would be different if they was, like, to realize that they are, like, part of that culture?
I mean, like I said, they know that they're Korean, they know that they're Irish, but I think because, like, it was a little different for me because I was kind of in a, grew up in a secluded area. Like, in living in Columbus, they're in a more diverse community, I would say. So they're surrounded by Africans, you know, they're surrounded by Hispanics, you know, they're exposed to so many different cultures now, as well as, you know, Asian, you know, Irish, you know, they have all of that. So I don't think they think about it as much because they, you know, they have more exposure to all the different cultures out there. And so I think their feelings about their heritage might be a little different from mine when I was their age growing up, if that makes any sense. Does that answer your question? Hopefully.
Oh, yes. Yes, it does. Thank you. So around this month, just like Black History Month and et cetera, I was just wondering how can, like, people take the time, like, during this month to, like, to educate themselves about Asians and Koreans? Because I know, like, there's a lot. Like, there's Chinese, Asian, and Korean, and some people don't realize the differences. And sometimes it's, like, offensive to call someone, like, Chinese when they're not Chinese. So, like, how can we as outsiders educate ourselves on this subject so therefore we don't sound racist when we talk to Asians?
Okay. So, first off, everybody from Asia is Asian. So, like, it's not, like, something different from, like, it's not Chinese, Asian, Korean. It's, like, everybody's Asian, but there's, like, different parts of, like, being Asian, you know? Basically. And then how you can support us is support your local businesses, support your local, like, Asian shops, support your, like just try things, you know, and support the community here, because there's a lot of, like, little, like, Nepali restaurants or, like, Nepali stores and stuff. And, like, you know, just try it out, I'd say, you know. And, like, if you don't like it, then you don't like it, but, like, at least you have a new experience.
To add on to Nishan, I'd say just, like, I don't know, whenever you don't have to, like, go outside of your comfort zone either. Whenever you're just talking to any, like, Asian you come across, just if you see that they get a little bit uncomfortable by some things you're saying, please, like, take it into account. Like, ask them, like, hey, what's wrong with what I said or something like that. And just, like, educate yourself. Like, Asian culture is so prevalent, and it's, like, people don't even realize it. Like, anime is so big. K-pop is so big, Bollywood is so big, and, like, you know, foods like sushi, they're so big within, like, outside cultures too, but, like, people don't recognize it, people don't take time to, like, educate themselves, like, outside of anime, outside of K-pop, you know, like, about the culture itself, about, like, how to appreciate it. So I'd say, like, just if you're into those things, just don't focus on that aspect, focus on the culture, focus on the entire thing as well, you know, and learn to appreciate all of that instead of, like, appropriating it. And kind of like Nishan said, support local businesses, listen to what your Asian peers are, like, have to say, and just, yeah, please don't, like, categorize us into these specific boxes you guys have, because there's so many stereotypes against Asian people, and we feel that we need to like fit in all these criteria in order to be Asian.
Hi guys, Rebecca again. On April 29th, the entire Cristo Rey community, students, teachers, staff, and board members celebrated Mass at St. Joseph Cathedral. Afterwards, Cristo Rey Columbus presented the annual Milt Shout Award. The Milt Shout Award is the highest honor that Cristo Rey Columbus can bestow upon a person who has significantly contributed to our school community. This year's recipient was Jim Foley, our school's founding president. Mr. Foley is no doubt one of the most instrumental people in bringing a Cristo Rey to Columbus. His leadership established a solid foundation to our school and left a legacy that will inspire us all for many years to come. Even though he's retired now, Mr. Foley never misses an episode of the Cristo Rey podcast. So Mr. Foley, we hope you're listening now. We miss you. Congratulations, and thank you for everything you have done for Cristo Rey.
Yeah, going off with what Shoshana said, if you start talking about something that happened in anime, the people are just going to look at you like you have like 10 heads, because that's not what it is. Like, it's some part of it, but like, they're going to see you as a fool if you keep on like bringing it up, like what happened there, because there's more than just the anime. There's also like with Japan, there's Japan's history. It's not just anime, and like anime doesn't really portray it properly. I mean, there's Bollywood, there's no like crazy romance and all that stuff. So yeah, just like, you go out and experience it.
Don't think our culture is just Bollywood or just K-pop or like just anime, you know? There's like so much to it. And it's like Asian culture is so rich with heritage, with like just difference and like so many aspects of it. There's so many aspects of Asian culture. Instead of using the stereotypes, you should like embrace the fact that it's different and that there's more than just what's on the surface. And like, you should respect that and like you should see Asian culture for more, like for what it is, instead of just like what's popular. That's what it is. Yeah, you should see Asian culture for what it is instead of what's popular, because what's popular doesn't always define a culture or like a group of people.
So like, should we learn about the history before like talking about all of this stuff? Because I think it's very important to learn about the history of what all of you guys went through, like all of your struggles and stuff, before just talking about, I'm gonna go eat sushi today, or I'm gonna go watch this Asian movie, but I don't know like the real backstory. Like if something bad happened and they had like a war that impacted this movie, but I'm going to go watch this movie and talk about it to other people. Is that like what you guys are saying?
No, what I'm saying is like appropriation versus appreciation. You don't have to understand every intricate detail of Nepal to enjoy a Nepali movie. You don't have to understand everything about Japan to watch anime. It's just, don't generalize and don't appropriate, you know, don't make it so that like don't make it seem like that's the only part of that culture, is what I'm trying to say. It's okay to ask questions, and it's okay to not know. Everybody doesn't know. It's just ask questions respectfully, and like if you are genuinely curious and want to know more, most likely and most of the time, if you say it in a respectful way, if you ask in a respectful way, like you will get the answer you're looking for. You will get more information about somebody's culture. Just do it in a respectful way is like all I'm trying to say, and like don't appropriate. I get assumptions a lot. A lot of people assume I'm Arabic. A lot of people assume that I'm Hispanic. A lot of people that assume that I'm Indian and stuff like that. So like, it's not, I mean, I don't really care about it, but I know a lot of people get offended by stuff like that. So it's just, it's smart to not assume and not to put labels on anybody, because anybody could be from anywhere. And like in general, you know, just like don't label and don't have stereotypes for people, you know, oh, they have small eyes, they're most definitely Asian, you know, like don't think like that. That's a terrible way to think. Just don't assume, just point blank, period. Do not assume. It's not going to end well if you assume. Maybe you'll assume right sometimes, but a lot of the times you will assume wrong. And I've had so many people assume wrong for me. So like from speaking from personal experience, just don't assume.
Right. I'm speechless. In a good way, because, like, you know, this was my first time knowing that Asian History Month. Like, it was last week when I knew it, because Sujanadi, she emailed me about Asian History Month podcasting, and I was like, we had that? I didn't know that.
Hey everyone, Ava here. As all the new information about college presents itself, including the 100% college acceptance, said earlier in the show, we know there is some nervousness and we hope to provide you a little bit of sanity. If you remember in 2019, the class president was Liana Greenlee. Here she is for some words of wisdom for all.
Hello, my name is Liana Greenlee and I graduated from Cristo Rey in 2019. A little bit about me is that I am about to graduate from Columbus State with my associate's and a general business degree, and in the fall, I will be going to Ohio State to study marketing. A lot of you are probably seniors right now. A word of advice is to make all the memories with your friends, soak it up, and also just get really excited for college. It's such an amazing new step in your life. You're gonna meet so many people and make these incredible connections to expand your worldview and to get you excited about your future. I'm excited about your futures. So stay positive, make all those memes, and yeah, it's gonna be great.
My encouragement for a lot of people, I think, is my favorite way of bridging. I love to bridge the Asian community in general. So I love learning about other cultures, especially Asian cultures. And the way that I like to do that is through food. And maybe, you know, this sounds interesting to you, but, you know, you mentioned Nepali restaurants. Like, I love to study other cultures through their food. And I believe that that's actually a really good way of learning about other people's cultures, appreciating other people's cultures. And I've taught my children, I'm teaching my children how to cook, how to try other foods from other cultures. And I think that's a really good way of bridging communities and gaining an understanding of other people's cultures is through food. So I actually really encourage everybody, hey, if you've never tried, you know, say Japanese cuisine, you know that, you know, go to a Japanese restaurant, you know, try their food, see, you know, talk to people about Japanese food. Like, people, you can really connect with other people through the venue of food. And I just encourage others to do that as well.
I completely agree with whatever Miss Corrigan said, because food just has, like, you know, food is food, food is life. And what better way to connect to culture than trying, like, all these different types of food and all that. And I also believe, like, music also plays a, like, very important role in experiencing another person's, like, culture, because every culture has their own music, has their own, just something about music, like, exploring the different genres, exploring the different, like, traditional tunes. It's just very enriching, and you can definitely see what type of culture they have through their music as well.
I think to add to what Shree said, trying different foods, because of how diverse, like, America is in general, but, like, especially, like, in Columbus and stuff, because of how diverse it is, you can try so many different types of things. And I feel like our culture is open to trying different foods and stuff. And, like, that's something that's very cool, because I think one of the best ways to appreciate a culture is by appreciating their food. Because who doesn't love food? And, you know, like, who doesn't love trying different foods? Trying different foods is one of the best venues, or, like, best ways to appreciate another culture or another person's culture.
I have to say, I also highly recommend the Columbus Asian Festival that they have. I believe it's in May, every May, during Asian month. So, yeah, I definitely encourage, if you want to learn more about Asian cultures, I definitely encourage you to go to the Columbus Asian Festival.
Well, thank you, everybody, for joining this podcast. But it was so enlightening to talk about Asian American heritage, and I really love chatting with you all. Thank you to all our guests and our special host, Mrs. Corrigan. Thank you guys for chatting with us, and that's the end of the Cristo Rey podcast.
Wait a minute. Wait, stop the music.
Mr. Corrigan, I got a question.
Yes.
So, you know the Cristo Rey podcast theme song?
Yes.
Oh. Is it almost the same one as the Star Wars one?
No.
Well, it depends.
I mean, the soundtrack is the same, and I noticed it, and I was watching Star Wars, and I'm like, wait, this sounds like the Cristo Rey podcast theme song. So is it actually from Star Wars?
Yeah, it's the theme to Star Wars, just with words.
Yeah.
Actually, you know, it was supposed to be a one-time joke.
Yeah, why wasn't it?
I don't know. it was supposed to, students were supposed to, the point was supposed to be so bad, yet it was so bad, it was like a contest when we started the podcast, like, it's so bad that anyone can do better. It was like to encourage students to write a theme song, and no one ever did, so then I just kept, doing it. Mrs. Corrigan hates it very much. She's very embarrassed. Yeah. So my youngest daughter, this was maybe 18 months ago or something, she had never seen Star Wars. And the older boys are into Star Wars, and they're watching Star Wars, and the music played. And she's like, "Daddy, Daddy, they're using your song in that movie." She thought I wrote it. So I'm not going to tell her.
Mommy, Daddy, what are you doing?
Oh, here she is now. Hey, say hello to everybody.
Hi.
Hey, tell them, what's your name?
Bridget.
How old are you, Bridget?
Seven.
Seven, huh? Do you think you could sing the song that Daddy wrote?
Podcast, Whisper Away Podcast, 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 Podcast, Whisper Away